Our service today expands on our monthly theme of wholeness by approaching the subject of spiritual or psychological wholeness. This is the month that many Americans have set aside for the practice of intense self-loathing. We make lists of all the things that we don't like about ourselves, and then we solemnly vow to banish them overnight by simply making a resolution. We decide that we would stop being whoever or however we've been starting on January 1st, and now we're starting to fail at it. And it makes us angry, it makes us disappointed in ourselves. One of the most pervasive New Year's resolutions, and one that is easy for us to examine, is to lose weight. And I think this is for a couple of reasons. One is that we all tend to overindulge at the holidays, and it seems reasonable to rein it in now that they are over. But I also think that the real reason is that this is an area where it's easy to get us to hate ourselves. And when we hate ourselves, it's easy to get us to buy things that we think will make us lovable. I found some examples of this marketing strategy through the decades. I made a little slideshow so we can explore this together. First, we have this vintage ad for Domino's Sugar, and the mother says, "Better go easy on that sugar. I thought you were counting calories." The daughter says, "You're wrong about sugar, mother. Sugar in tea or coffee at every meal gives fewer calories than your reducing salad." So there's a lot going on in this ad. But I want to point out two things here. Beyond the surface level of ridiculousness, there's actually some pretty sinister stuff happening here. One, the daughter doesn't have any food in front of her, just a cup of coffee that she's about to put sugar in, and her dialogue has implied that one only needs sugar and coffee or tea to live, and that that is a reasonable way to lose weight when it is, in fact, very dangerous and not a way to lose weight. And two, the tagline says it's smart to say slim and trim and get the Domino's energy lift, too. So beyond the ridiculousness that sugar is a reasonable way to diet and to get an energy lift, the subtext here is that smart people can lose weight and be thin. Therefore, people who are not thin are not smart, right? So this next slide is actually two ads. On the left, we have a woman standing in front of a fireplace while a man looks at her, and we see him from behind, so we share his perspective. The text reads, "How slender you were in the glow of the fire. Would he think so now?" And on the right is an image of a woman looking seethingly at another woman's figure with the message, "Is this the day you finally do something about your weight? All it takes is a little bit of willpower and Metrihel." So this set of messages are based quite literally in the male gaze and female acrimony. It should also be noted that Metrical was linked to several deaths, and that's why it no longer exists. Our third slide is an ad for Warner's women's shaving undercuts. The image is a pair with the text that says, "This is no shave for a girl." So we learn from this ad that some naturally occurring body shapes are inherently wrong. Next up, we have a little girl wearing a shirt with the infamous Kate Moss quote, "Nothing tastes as good as skinny feels." Now, perhaps the most ubiquitous supermodel of the 1990s, Kate Moss later said that she regretted saying this. But once something like that gets into the world, it tends to stay. And people put it on shirts and then model it with 10-year-old girls. And lastly, controversial shirt from a few years ago from Urban Outfitters that simply says, "Eat less." Now, the slogan, "Eat less," implies that everyone is fat, or perhaps everyone but the wearer. clarified message that eating less leads to weight loss, which it doesn't, reinforces the incorrect belief that weight management is simply a matter of caloric intake, which can be managed through willpower and smart. So we see that this negative and incorrect approach to weight loss was begun a very long time ago, before the 60s, but it's been perpetuated in a certain way, regurgitated differently throughout the decades. Okay, we can go ahead and take this down now. Thank you. It's easy to see the pervasiveness of the message that we are only lovable, or perhaps most lovable, when we look a certain way. And in January, we are inundated with commercials for weight loss plans. In every corner of the media, we find celebrities and former athletes talking about all the weight that they've lost using this product or following that plan. Now, I've noticed recently that the tone of these ads has changed slightly from lose weight to get and or keep a romantic partner to lose weight so that you can live your best life. Now that seems like a more positive message on the surface, but if we accept that we can't live our best life as we are, what's really lurking below the surface is still lose weight so that you can be lovable. Our media is dominated by an impossible beauty standard, especially in regards to body shape and size. Now, I realize that this has shifted slightly in recent years, but seeing people with average or bigger bodies in the mainstream media is still the exception and draws attention when it happens. I recently read a very disturbing article about the actor Henry Cavill in his regime to prepare for shirtless scenes. He uses a technique called forced dehydration so that his muscles look bigger. 4 days before the shoot, he allows himself to drink 1.5 liters of water. 2 liters is the recommended daily amount. The next day, he drinks 0.5 liter, and then he doesn't drink any water until after filming ends on the 4th day. Now, for those of you who don't know, Henry Cavill plays Superman. Superman has to dangerously dehydrate himself so that he can look like Superman. This is madness. And weight loss is just one of the many resolutions that people make in the new year. We also resolve that we'll get our finances together, that we'll mend relationships, we'll read a ton of books, we'll clean the house every single day, the list goes on. There is nothing wrong with setting a course for how you want to spend your time in the new year or for thinking about how you want to round out your life. What worries me is the idea that we're not worthy, we're not lovable, or really living our best lives until we do those things. We say things like, when I finish school, I'll take better care of myself. When I retire, I'll make more time for family and fun. When I get married, I'll be okay. When I get myself together, I'll love myself. We withhold love and care from ourselves as a punishment for not being who we want to be. Most of us are convinced down to our bones that there is something wrong with us or something missing from our lives. We think of ourselves as the current, incomplete us, and also then the future better us. But there is only one you. You are the only you that exists. There is no different version of you that is more worthy of love. There is no skinny you, there is no financially solvent you, there is no more organized you, or whatever it is that you dream of when you make your resolutions. There's just you, today, as you are. Change in our lives is possible, yeah. But waiting to love ourselves until we achieve that change is folly. You are currently and always worthy of love. This tendency to think about ourselves as the unlovable current us and the lovable future us is an artificial division of the self that keeps us in the cycle of suffering. Healing this division or duality is a dominant theme in what we call Eastern religion. Today we'll focus on one of the many corners of Buddhism, specifically the Heart Sutra, as translated by Thich Nhat Hanh. I say this is one of many corners as a reminder that no religion is monolithic, and what I present today is a way of understanding Buddhism and the Heart Sutra, not the way of understanding them. The human tendency to form mental dualities is ancient. Buddhism refers to these dualities as misperceptions, illusions, or obstacles. Thich Nhat Hanh's version of the Heart Sutra says, "Bodhisattvas who practice the insight that brings us to the other shore see no more obstacles in their mind. And because there are no obstacles in the mind, they can overcome all fear, destroy all wrong perceptions, and realize perfect nirvana." Nirvana being release from the difficulties of the world and rebirth, which is a goal of Buddhist practice, but not always meant literally, as in rebirth within this lifetime. The path to realization of nirvana is blocked by the perception that there are dualities. Those dualities are overcome by mental and spiritual practice of non-duality, oneness, wholeness. Non-duality can mean a lot of things, but today I want to employ this concept, non-duality, at the individual level. Our tendency to think of ourselves as being currently unlovable and unworthy because of whatever reason versus a lovable future us is a duality. It is a false separation of that which is inherently one. Going to the text again, we find a list of things that appear to be opposites: birth and death, being and non-being, defilement, purity, increasing and decreasing. The section begins, "All phenomena bear the mark of emptiness." This is probably the most well-known of all of the Buddhist texts to say emptiness is form and form is emptiness. That's beautiful to say, and it's interesting to think about, but its meaning is not readily apparent. I think we hear it, we all go, yes. And then someone says, what does that mean? We say, and then we just repeat the text again. The Buddhist sacred texts, like all sacred texts, are not meant to be just accepted at face value. We're meant to wrestle with them, to turn them over in our mind like a gem being polished until a deeper meaning is revealed. Since we're not a sangha, I'm just going to tell you, I'm going to give you a little shortcut. By saying that what is seemingly opposite, form and emptiness, birth and death, saying that those things are the same, we are to understand that there are no divisions. All divisions are constructs of our mind. They are perceptions. And it is the realization that everything that we perceive is in truth unified, a unified whole, rather than separate phenomenon, that is what heals the divisions within ourselves. There is no present you and future you. There is only you. We break the cycle of facing the the same lessons, the same heartaches, the same difficulties, the same suffering over and over again. That rebirth and rebirth to the same lesson. And that is the insight that brings us to the other shore. Which brings us to the powerful mantra at the end of the sutra. Gate gate, pare gate, parasamgate, bodhisattva. Most of this doesn't translate exactly into English. The word gate means gone. The word para means the river bank that is opposite from the bank you are standing on. This word is also used to refer to Buddhists who have achieved enlightenment. They are on the other shore. The word bodhi means awakening, or one who is following the path of the Buddha. The rest of the words convey emphasis in some way or another. The person who instructed me in Buddhism translated the mantra, gone, gone, really gone, really, really gone, gone beyond everything, man. We heard a version, a translation from our choir today, Brian Tate. And I found another version from Allen Ginsberg. This one's funny. Gone, gone, totally gone, over the top, awakened minds. The word svaha just means yeah at the end. So that's what that's about. A more serious translation is, oh, awakening that has gone, gone, gone to the further shore, gone completely to that further shore. Amen. This is why Thich Nhat Hanh uses the phrase, the insight that brings us to the other shore, instead of using the shorthand enlightenment. It sounds really beautiful and vague. What he's actually trying to do here is be illustrative. And again, this is not something that you hear and then grasp, and now you got it. You guys are all going to be in coffee hour going, yeah, what was that? It's okay, we just turn this over and over in our mind. It's meant to be worked out in the mind and the heart over time and not just accepted. When we do grasp this concept or something close to it, the false separations begin to fall away. We realize that we aren't missing any pieces. We are who we're meant to be in this world. We will never be somebody else. And all efforts that we put into becoming a fictional future version of ourselves only creates suffering in our lives, and probably in the lives of those around us who love us. When we stop trying to force ourselves into some idea of who we are and what we're supposed to be, much like Ananda, that is when we achieve that state above reliving the same painful difficulties over and over again. We leave the eternal hamster wheel of trying to get someplace that we can't go. Our Unitarian Universalist faith affirms that you have inherent worth and dignity. This idea is influenced by some branches of Christianity that incorporated Gnostic philosophy, and also by this idea from Hinduism and Buddhism that captured the minds of Thoreau and Emerson. The blending of that idea that we now have, that is just true. We have inherent worth and dignity now, always. You are worthy now. You deserve love, and you deserve the care of yourself and those closest to you. Now, there is no future you that is better. You are good enough, and probably better than you think, right now. Maybe so.